And they started really early as a musician.
To begin with, I'm the youngest of five in my musical family. And my brothers actively continued on a professional basis. Mm-hmm. One of my brothers actually had a splash of fame dealing with a group back in the late 70s, early 80s that was kind of in the vein of Earth, Wind, and Fire called Nature's Divine. Mm-hmm. And
I know of them, yeah.
They had a hit called I Just Can't Control Myself.
Yeah,
and my brother was the lead singer in that mm-hmm. group. The horn section consisted of Charles Green and old Pelton Parker, brother of Ray Parker Jr.,
yeah.
actually. And I mention this because it was very pivotal that I met Mr. Green through my brother, because he actually stayed at our house. Mm-hmm. And as a result of him staying at our house, his instruments were available to me. He had at the time a soprano, an alto, and a tenor saxophone, all of which were Selmers, flute and clarinet and bass clarinet, which I think were Selmers as well. Maybe not the flute, but the clarinets were anyway. So I had a love affair with his alto, which was a Mark VI factory gold plated. Mm-hmm. I mean, woo!
The bomb.
Well, I couldn't actually play it at the time, mm-hmm. but I was
it
in love
good.
With how it looked and felt and all that, and which I'm going to get into a smidge a little later on.
Mm-hmm.
But the fact was, what really clinched it and brought it home was the fact that he was there at the house along with his instruments, and I would have these brief encounters with them where I was upstairs, he was staying in my old room,
mm-hmm.
and I would sneak up and take his instrument out, mm-hmm. you know, this one in particular, and I was real meticulous on making sure I didn't draw attention to myself, and mm-hmm. I obviously couldn't put the mouthpiece on because
yeah.
it would certainly tell yeah. on what I was doing.
The alarm bell was
so, there. Had a full-length mirror, and so I was posing like on the album covers with the, you know, with the horn and the mirror
mm-hmm.
and all that.
Mm-hmm.
I was doing all the cool, you know, poses and stuff mm-hmm. and the ones that look like I'm in business.
Mm-hmm.
All the different moves and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So, and they call me, hey, Dre's, where are you? I put his horn up and, you know.
Yeah.
So this happened on several occasions. And then the final time I really became, you know, oblivious to what was going on, and he came upstairs and mm-hmm. caught me. Jim, what are you doing my horn? And I was like, mm-hmm. you know, he busted me.
Mm-hmm.
And he saw where my fingers were located, and he was like, all right, let me see, you know, put the instrument back. Just put
right.
it, put it down, put it back.
Mm-hmm.
He actually said put it down, but I proceeded to take it apart, put the neck swab and, you know, in-plug on the top of it, put the neck in its separate compartment,
right.
put it in back in the case, and
you know what to do with it.
Yeah.
yeah.
And he went downstairs and told my brother and my folks, I think, you know, James wants to play saxophone.
Mm.
So I wasn't out of the woods yet. In order for that to happen, I had to find one of my own
mm-hmm.
That was under $200. And that meant in circa 79, 80, to go into the paper and look through all these small classified
yeah.
ads, pre-internet and all that, mind you.
Yeah.
And
check the lists.
And highlight or, you know, circle, well, it was circle in this case,
mm-hmm.
something that was under $200. And thank heavens I found a guy that was selling instruments. He was a former school teacher in the Oak Park District, which is a suburb of Detroit.
Mm-hmm.
Who was selling instruments for altos were $125 and up. So that was right in the budget.
Yeah.
So we arranged, called him up and arranged the time to go out there to meet him and for me to check out the instruments and to have Charles. He actually picked out my first instrument, which I still own to this day. And still plays,
mm-hmm.
I might add.
You're playing today?
Yeah. Not on a regular basis, but it's still
Sometimes.
operable and all that. So that's how it started with me, you know. And but going back a smidgen, like I mentioned, I feel that you don't choose the arts. The arts chooses you, you know. And I say that particularly from a firsthand standpoint because I got involved in jazz because of watching my mom do chores, and that was the ambiance that she had on was either radio station or various records that, you know, harken back to her formative years in school. And always, for the most part, it was vocalists that were, you know, on these albums. You know, Billie Holiday, Sarah Vaughan, Ella Fitzgerald, you know, Conor McRae, Betty Carter, Ed Infinite, you know. And always when the vocals were over with, it seemed like this sound was there. Eight times out of ten. And I was like, dang, I dig that sound. But it turns out it was a saxophone, I found out. So I heard it first and dug it. Then when I saw the pictures of how it looked like on album covers, which, you know,
something.
When you can see something like that on vinyl and hold it up like that, as opposed to a shrink-wrapped CD jacket, which you'd have to hope that you can get that same vibe off of, you know, I saw what it looked like on the vinyl covers. I was like, wow. So physically, I was blown away from it, you know. And then, like I aforementioned, with Charles coming in, you know, later on, I mean, that just isn't happenstance or just some sort of coincidence that here I am, you know, feet deep into loving the saxophone, and here's this boarder that comes in and just happens to play one.
Yeah.
You know, there's a higher power that's at work when these situations make themselves evident, you know. And to be able to be thankful and to acknowledge that and to be thankful of it, you know, and want to be in service of it. That's always the optimist objective.